I'm extremely happy when I'm around my airplanes. Life is less complicated. When I'm flying them, I focus entirely on the flying. I find that refreshing. I find the planes are beautiful in and of themselves, so in the same way somebody else might collect art, you can collect planes. I'm a flyer. I only have as many planes as I fly.
Neurobiology and the human genome might seem strange bedfellows to the love of flying. But then you might not know Peter Ram, a scientist and groundbreaker in his profession, but a flyer pure of heart.
Flying is simple, directly connected to your motor skills. There's very little theoretical aspect to flying. There are very few uncertainties in flying. You're either doing it correctly or incorrectly. Science is quite the opposite. Everything you're doing is wrong, you just don't know it yet. I find the two are refreshing counterparts.
In the spring of 2007, Peter went shopping for an airplane. Not just any airplane, he knew he wanted something special. What he would find would propel him on a 70-year-old journey through history. A journey of discovery that not even science can match.
I was actually looking at a quite different plane, a Spartan Executive, which is a single-engine, smaller plane from the late 30s. I got some pictures, and in the background, I saw just a few features of another airplane. I said, wait a minute, that's a Lockheed 12. At which point, the Spartan vanished, didn't exist anymore. I was a goner at that point. It belonged to a fellow named Colgate Darden, Colgate W. Darden III. I liked Colgate, I liked his airplane. And so I went through whatever I had to go through to get it. But to tell you the truth, the instant I saw it sitting in his hangar, I was sold. The aircraft is a bullet. It was built for speed. It's narrow. It's small windows. It's steeply sloping, so inside you're climbing up to get to the cockpit. In the cockpit, you're looking out through these little beetle windows. Everything sacrificed for speed. It has character because of that. It's not simply an efficient people mover. It's an engineer's dream. In fact, the great Kelly Johnson built it, designed it, who later designed the U-2 and the SR-71 Blackbird. This was his first baby. And you see it in the lines. The lines are those of a piece of Art Deco. And it just clicks with me. I just really like it.
By the mid-30s, the Lockheed Corporation, having emerged from bankruptcy due to the Great Depression, were determined to produce a line of transports that would be the best the world had seen. The result was the Lockheed 10, a fast 12-seat people mover that immediately became a hit with airlines, and the airplane of choice for one very notable aviator of the era.
Amelia Earhart flew a Lockheed 10. The advantage of the Lockheed 10 was that it was a reasonably large airplane, and she filled the entire interior with fuel tanks. Never quite enough fuel.
With the success of the 10, Lockheed recognized the need for a smaller executive transport. Cleverly, they took the 10, reduced it by 10%, but kept the same engines. Now being able to carry 6 to 8 people, the new Lockheed 12 became the fastest transport of its time.
You're getting on that plane.
I don't understand. What about you?
In Casablanca, Ingrid Bergman climbed aboard a Lockheed 12 moments after saying goodbye to Humphrey Bogart. In the late 1930s, Sidney Cotton was a rogue aviator who equipped his Lockheed 12 with hidden cameras and secretly photographed German war installations, often while he had German military officers in the aircraft. Of the 130 Lockheed 12s produced, only 25 survive today, and of those, only 10 are airworthy. But not Peter Ram's, not yet. His goal is to completely disassemble and then restore the aircraft.
My major obstacle in this project is the aircraft itself. It's an old, old aircraft. The wiring is 70 years old. The control cables, the cables that connect the rudders, they're totally unsafe. They all need to be replaced. We are replacing only the worst skins. The rest will stay just the way they are. The instrument panel will be antique on the right, with all original instruments, and modern on the left so that we can actually fly this aircraft in complex modern airspace.
When Peter and I were conducting the pre-purchase inspection on the airplane, And going through its historical records, we discovered that it had RCAF history. It was used by the Royal Canadian Air Force during the war years. And as we learned about the history and finding out the operators, Texaco, Noble Oil and Drilling, and all these very interesting companies from the 30s, it gives it a real nostalgic, golden age, mechanical age charm. So we're going to try and bring that out during the restoration. And if the airplane could tell us a story of where it's been, it would just be fabulous.
When you restore a piece of history, there's two ways to look at it. In the one case, we're restoring a machine that is rare and valuable and in and of itself interesting. And we want to preserve it so that people can see the technology of that day. In the other case, we're restoring something that has a functional significance. In other words, it did something, and that's what we're honoring.
By the late 1930s, the Government of Canada was struggling with the formation of Trans-Canada Airlines. In order to prove to the naysayers that it was possible to travel across Canada in a single day, C.D. Howe, the Minister of Transport, climbed aboard a Lockheed 12 in Montreal and set out for Vancouver. It had never been done before.
They did it. They ran into some evil weather, they had to turn back, they ran into a thunderstorm, but they made it to Vancouver in 17 hours. And so what was the 12 in Canada? It was a pathbreaker.
The actual plane that flew the first cross-Canada flight in 1937 resides at the Canada Aviation Museum in Ottawa. It hasn't flown in decades. There it rests, a testament to the vision of Canada's early transport pioneers. For the recreation flight, Peter and his team turn their focus to its sister.
Yes, we're restoring a rare and valuable and beautiful aircraft that represents the apex of the technology of its day. But we're also honoring the role that aviation played in opening up Canada and in unifying Canada, this huge, wide country.
On pull on the outboard side to remove the wing.
The team reaches its first major hurdle as they prepare to remove a wing.
I'm going to get on the wing tip and I'm going to be somewhat aggressive by lifting the wing up and then down slightly.
By getting their first look at the condition of the spar, the course for the year-long restoration will be set.
Nobody's seen that spar for 70 years. Nobody knows what sort of condition it's in. It's a critical part of the airplane. It's going to be a very exciting day.
Start working the wing towards me, fellas. Don't push the stands, but move the wing.
The wing actually has to be pulled apart effortlessly without trying to stress any other parts of the structure of the airplane. And it's quite a chore. This is a big moment today for us. It's a big step today, and I'm nervous about it.
Yeah, we've got some action here, quarter inch. Yep. Okay, back and forth. There you go. Hold it.
Once this project is complete and we've actually made this glorious flight, I'm going to feel that we've verified a year of work for all these people, because that is a challenging flight. This aircraft did it when it was new, and it'll do it when it's 70 years old. And it'll only do it when it's 70 years old because we worked so hard on it.
The Lockheed 12 was a pathbreaker, having proved the theory of nationwide air travel through the science of flight. For Peter Ram, himself a pathbreaking scientist in neurobiology, his worlds are not that far apart after all. By restoring this rare and historic plane and flying it across the country in a single day, he and his team are set to become pathbreakers all over again.
When this is all wrapped up, I'm going to step back. I'm going to just look at her for a while. Then I'm going to take some of my good friends, my children, and I'm going to go flying.
You must remember this. A kiss is still a kiss. A sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental thing. As time goes by, and when two lovers woo, they still say, I love you. On that, you can rely, no matter what the pictures.